It was Hinditron's 55th birthday, not Santosh Kejriwal. Correction there.
Yes, that is right.
Kamlesh Sunawala.
You're right. Thank you for the correction. Sapna? Are you there, Sapna?
Okay, sorry, I think I was on mute. Hi, good morning, everyone. I'm extremely delighted to welcome Suveer Bajaj to the Rotary Club of Bombay Midtown today. A management and law graduate from Mumbai University, Suveer is co-founder of Foxymoron, one of India's leading independent digital products and services agencies. Founded in 2008, the firm has built several sustainable partnerships with companies like L'Oreal, Netflix, Colgate, Amazon India, Burger King, and IKEA, amongst others. Suveer has been instrumental in building the organization through strategic alliances, partnerships, and corporate development initiatives. He was part of the 40 under 40 list by Impact Magazine in 2018. It's under his leadership that Foxymoron has consistently been ranked as one of the top media agencies in the country and has been the recipient of several awards over the years, including the Social Media Agency of the Year Award by AgencyCon in 2019. Suveer is extremely passionate about his work, but having known him personally, I can truly say that his zest, his enthusiasm goes beyond his work and permeates every aspect of his life, be it hobbies like scuba diving in the Andamans and skiing in the mountains, to supporting various causes through NGOs, and more recently, launching a series of podcasts aimed at bringing about a paradigm shift in the way we perceive our neighbors. So without further ado, I now hand it over to Suveer, welcome him, and I request him to take it forward from here. Thank you.
Thank you so much for that introduction, and thank you for having me at this meeting for the Rotary Club of Bombay Midtown. I'm going to share my screen before I jump in. I think the host may need to enable...
One moment, give me a moment.
Yeah.
Yeah, go ahead, you'll be able to share.
You're on.
Yeah, cool. Is my screen visible?
Yes.
Yes.
Okay, excellent. Okay. So thank you so much for having me today, and I hope everyone is doing as well as they possibly can given the conditions in our country today. I'm here to talk to you about podcasts today and about a project that I've initiated recently called 883 to Infinity. To start off with, let me give you a quick introduction to myself before we jump in. A little bit about me. I'm 33 years old. I live in Bombay. Outside of my time at work, I love to play tennis. I swim. I listen to a lot of music. I dive. I ski. Something that wasn't part of my introduction is that I too have been part of the Rotaract movement. And I heard a little bit of chatter before we started this call about the Sergeant at Arms. And in 2015, I was the Sergeant at Arms at the Rotaract Club of HR College. I was also the Director of Professional Development, and I spent 5 years in the Rotaract Club of HR College. So I do have a little bit of lineage to what we did call 3140 back then, but I understand now, I think that things have changed and we're 3141 now, if I understand correctly. So that's a little bit about me. As you heard in my introduction, I started a digital marketing agency called Foxymoron in the year 2008, which is one of India's largest independent digital marketing agencies headquartered in Bombay. We have offices across Bombay, Delhi, and Bangalore, and a team of about 300 people that sits across the board. Broadly speaking, we function at the intersection of digital content, digital solutions, at the intersection of content, media, data, and technology. Over the last 2 years, this agency actually has moved into a holding company structure called the Zoo Media Group, which now holds 7 different agencies, of course, Foxymoron being the lead agency, along with 6 other agencies that work in the space of consulting, advisory, talent management, content production and video solutions, creation of intellectual property and digital assets and destinations, marketing tech, ad tech, and creative technology. Briefly speaking, some of the clients that we work with include Netflix, Amazon, L'Oreal, Burger King, Hershey's, Colgate, just to name a few. And there are a bunch of logos on the screen that a lot of you may be familiar with as on the screen as well. Though, however, I'm not here to talk to you guys about digital marketing, which is my mainstay business. I'm here to talk to you today about 883 to Infinity, which is a podcast initiative that was started in February of this year with the initiative to build transformational dialogue between the youth of India and Pakistan in the lens of culture, community, and content. Now, I understand that a lot of people on this platform may not necessarily be familiar with the idea of a podcast. So I decided to take a step back and start off by telling you what a podcast is. Now, for those who are not familiar with what a podcast typically is a digital audio file that's made available on the internet that can be accessed on a computer or a mobile phone. And typically, it equates the exact same relationship that the radio had to our lives, or the radio still has to our lives, but becomes slightly less relevant today than it was maybe 10, 20, or 30 years ago. The difference between a podcast and a radio show is that usually on a podcast, people spend time talking to one another and discussing engaging subjects, and we do not broadcast music. The job of radio typically is to broadcast music, which we don't do, and our job typically is to discuss engaging subjects that keep our users engaged. Now, one would ask, why do people listen to podcasts? So typically, people listen to podcasts because the subjects discussed in podcasts may be interesting. Listeners may get the opportunity to learn something new, or they may be informative in nature. A lot of podcasts are also very educational, and you get to learn a lot about facts when it comes to history or current affairs or technology or whatever the theme of the podcast is that you're choosing to follow. And of course, all podcasts are entertaining as well. When do people listen to podcasts? So typically, podcast listening behavior falls into three large categories. So we spend a lot of time in our cars, on vehicles, commuting when we get to work. Of course, this behavior is slightly less relevant over the course of the last 1 year while we've been locked up in our houses and working from home. But typically prior to last year, when we did spend a lot of time in our vehicles, commuting to and fro from work, is one of the largest behavioral patterns when people listen to podcasts, or when you do your daily chores, if you like to cook, for example, or you wash the dishes, or you arrange your cupboards or your closets, when you do daily chores that don't necessarily require the active participation of your brain, you could listen to podcasts because you get to learn something new and be entertained at the same time. And when you do monotonous exercise activities, such as going for a walk in the evening or going for a jog in the evening, that don't require active participation, like playing tennis, for instance, where, of course, you would not be able to listen to a podcast. So these become the three large behavioral patterns of when people are consuming podcasts. Who's listening to podcasts in India today? So, of course, as you can rightly imagine, a large chunk of the youth is 18 to 35 because they're digitally savvy. They know which podcasts are out. They know which podcasts are relevant. They have a penchant for hunger. They have a hunger for, learning new things. They have a penchant for entertainment, and they like interacting with different content creators from around the world. 46% of urban India today listens to podcasts, and 52% of non-metro listens to podcasts today. On an average, people consume about 26 minutes of content every day on podcasts, which is typically the amount of time it would take for me to get from here to my office, or for example, if I go for a walk in the evening post-work hours. One out of every three people actually listens to a podcast every single day, and this could be a combination of me following a variety of different podcasts, and most podcasts publish one episode a week. So that gives me the flexibility to listen to seven different episodes of seven different podcasts every week and learn about seven different matters, seven different subjects that could range from art to entertainment to technology to culture to lifestyle. In India, we have 40 million daily listeners in the podcasting market. That's not a very large number. To give you context, we have about 746 million active television watchers in India today. So in comparison, 40 million is not a very large number in comparison to television. Now, for example, on the internet, we have 696 million active Indians that access the internet every single month. So that's not a very large number in context to the overall active population of the internet in India today. But it's a very, very new medium today. It's only a 1.5-year-old medium in India today. And therefore, the number is a very actively growing number that will continue to grow for the next few years. How do you listen to podcasts? So where do you find podcasts? So podcasts are typically found on radio streaming platforms on the internet, Apple Music being one. Of course, you're familiar with Gaana and Saavn, which are typically audio streaming softwares. But all of these audio streaming softwares stream not only music, but also podcasts as well. Our largest podcast distributor, of course, is Apple Music, Spotify, and Google Podcasts, which contribute to over 70% of podcasts consumed in India. So while I've spent a few minutes talking to you guys about the background of podcasts and what podcasting is as an industry today, let me jump straight into what I'm here to talk to you guys about today, which is 883 to Infinity. Now, where was the idea of my podcast born? I'd like to give you guys a little bit of a background and an introduction to where this idea was born from, prior to jumping in and telling you what it's all about. So in the year 2006, I attended something called the LUMUN, which stands for the Lahore University of Management Sciences Model United Nations. So while I was in college, I was very actively part of the Model UN Society, which organized mock UNs. Now, for those of you that are not familiar with the MUN concept, an MUN typically is a simulation of the United Nations in which students participate in a debate style fashion, representing certain countries and discussing topics of global significance as if we were mocking a session of the United Nations. I, for one, actually organized the HR MUN, which was my college, HR College's Model United Nations session, which in 2006 was the largest such conference in Asia. It then gave me the opportunity to travel the world and represent my college and my country at such events across the country and the world. One such event was the Lahore University of Management Sciences Model United Nations, where in 2006, I got the opportunity to travel to the beautiful Lahore. Now, this is a feat that not a lot of people can talk about and not a lot of our, not a lot of our friends can really boast of. A little background, as my mama Vicky discussed, I am his nephew. And by that, a lot of you would have inferred that a lot of our family does actually come from undivided India. And we do have our roots in a state called Sindh, which now occupies itself in Pakistan. And therefore, we do have our roots and our heritage and our cultural heritage in Sindh, which today sits in Pakistan. As you can imagine, when we spent 2 weeks in Lahore, we traveled the city, we got to consume its sights, its sounds. Most importantly, we got to consume its food, which was absolutely delicious, as you can imagine, with the Mughlai cuisine there. But having said that, we also built a lot of friendships, and these friendships have really stood the test of time. We built friendships with a lot of Pakistanis from Lahore, but from Islamabad, from Karachi, from smaller parts of the country as well. And, you know, as we got to know these people, we realized they're just like us. And we were quite shocked by our experiences over there. Of course, I was only 18 when I traveled to Pakistan. And there was a lot of nervousness because Pakistan was always perceived to be an area of threat and, you know, the stories that people tell. And of course, we've heard a lot of stories from our family about their partition experiences. But more recently, of course, as we've grown up, in our generation, we've heard stories that date closer to our time with regards to a lot of the border conflict and the strife. And there was a lot of nervousness going in, but also a lot of excitement and enthusiasm. And when we did go, we realized they're just like us, and they made us feel at home. They made us feel very secure. They made us feel very safe, and they gave us a time of our lives. In fact, it's safe to say that going to Pakistan has been one of the best experiences of my life, not only from the perspective of it being fulfilling culturally, but also from the perspective of it being a lovely holiday, meeting lovely people, visiting a lovely city, and eating lovely food. But the idea for the podcast, of course, was not born in 2006 because there were no podcasts in 2006. Also, at the age of 18, we weren't necessarily as culturally stimulated as we are today. We weren't as aware about geopolitics, about the cultural sensitivities of the world as we are today in our grown-up years. The idea for the podcast was actually born as recently as last year in 2020. Now, a lot of you on this call are very familiar to this slide. What did we do last summer while we were locked up in our homes, when there was absolutely no work to do and we were struggling and grappling at straws, you know, at the remnants of our business that businesses that were struggling to stay afloat last year? We spent a lot of time watching TV. We spent a lot of time watching content, being locked up in our houses, afternoons and evenings with nowhere to go. We consumed a lot of content. I, for one, started consuming a lot of content and started consuming a lot of Bollywood content, which I don't otherwise consume. Some of the movies and shows that I watched are on the screen in front of you. I'm not sure whether you've gotten the opportunity to watch any of these movies, but I watched a movie called Romeo Akbar Walter. I watched a very popular web series on Amazon called Patal Lok. I watched a film called The Ghazi Attack starring Rana Dugabatti. And I watched several other such films that my friends would recommend to me and send me over WhatsApp messages. And I noticed one common theme between all these movies. So in all these movies, there was one protagonist. Let's say it was John Abraham in the first. Let's say it was Rana Dugabatti in the third. And of course, there was some strife or some struggle. And there was some antagonist. In all the movies and all the shows that I watched, which were several, which were not only three, there were maybe 30. The one common thread is that irrespective of what the actual facts were that inspired the movie, the terrorist was a Pakistani. And typically, the more I studied and the more I researched, I realized that Indian media has the habit to paint Pakistan or Pakistanis as the bad guy in everything they do. Irrespective of whether a movie or a show is based on true events, like in the case of the guy in the center, Patal Lok, which is inspired by true events, in which they cite a variety of different terror groups, a lot of which have their own homes and residence in India. In the story, the media portrayed the bad guys to be Pakistani. Now, what do innocent consumers like you and me think? The only impression that we are going to get is that all terror in India comes from Pakistan or is funded by Pakistan. Therefore, the impression that we get today is that all Pakistanis are terrorists, or all Pakistanis are bad. Now, we realize that we do have geopolitical conflict with Pakistan. We do have history that leads back to 1947. We do have a disputed territory in Kashmir that we've been fighting over and fighting for since 1947. We have border skirmishes every day. We've had three major wars with the country. However, we are still cut from the same cloth. This partition that happened in 47, which was cut very indiscriminately by Ratcliffe, you know, who drew out the border, has left a lot of people begging for, you know, their families that got cut out in half, etc. And therefore, the people, when we went there, we realized the people aren't necessarily at loggerheads with each other. The governments are at loggerheads with each other. But what is the government doing? What is the media doing? It's taking the opportunity to paint this picture in our heads as innocent consumers of this media that all Pakistanis are bad and Pakistan is the enemy. So while watching this movie, this thought upset me a lot. So what I did is I picked up the phone and I called my good friend Umair Qazi, of course, who I met when I went to Pakistan in 2006. And of course, we had remained friends, as you can imagine, with a variety of different Pakistanis that I met. Now, Umair today is based out of Karachi. Very coincidentally, Umair is also Sindhi, actually not too coincidentally, because he lives in Karachi, which is the capital of Sindh. So Umair is also Sindhi. Umair also started an advertising agency like me many years ago and is a young advertising entrepreneur. So we've got that in common. So he's an ad man as well. And like how I had the opportunity to travel to Pakistan in 2006, Umair had the opportunity to travel to India in 2008. So we both had that in common, that we were both young and we had the opportunity to visit each other's countries and experience each other's cultures firsthand. Now, because we're both ad men and we are part of this media industry, it is easy for us to understand what the role of media is when it comes to telling stories and when it comes to shaping public opinion. However, the role of media has changed drastically over the last few years, because in a lot of your generations, while you were growing up, media was limited to reading the newspaper every morning and watching the news on television every night. So the role of print and the role of television held a very, very high place in terms of regard of media in our country. However, today, the role of media is very, very influenced by the world of digital. And that means that this world is connected. That gives me the opportunity to pick up the phone on my friend in Pakistan and have a conversation with him every day. It gives me the opportunity to now record that conversation and broadcast that conversation to a variety of different listeners who wish to listen to these thoughts. And that's where the idea for the podcast was born. So when Umair and I chatted, we exchanged notes and we said, look, we are young entrepreneurs in the media industry. We have the ability to effect change. How can we start doing that? Can we start doing that with a media format that we are comfortable with, which is digital? And can we institutionalize change? And we said, yes, the generation has changed. Today, our generation does not have the same generation that our forefathers did with respect to Pakistan because of partition. So if there's been a change in the generation, should we not now change the narrative? And we compared a lot of other thriving parts of the world, the EU, for instance, when neighboring countries are best friends and you don't even need a visa to drive into your neighboring country. You just need to take your passport and get it stamped at the border. So if there's a change in generation, should we not change the narrative? And is it not time for change when we rewrite this narrative between the people of the country? Of course, we can't really influence the government's take on this, but can we not influence the people's take on the country to build a narrative of friendship, peace, by celebrating our similarities? And that's where the idea for 883 to Infinity was born. Now, before I tell you what we talk about on this podcast, I want to spend a few seconds talking to you about what this name means. Now, what does 883 to Infinity mean? So, like I spoke about in the European Union, it's possible for you to get into your car this morning and drive down to your friend in a neighboring country and have lunch with him. The objective of neighboring countries harboring this sense of friendship is what we're trying to celebrate here. So the distance between Bombay and Karachi is 883 kilometers. If I got into my car today, I could drive 883 kilometers and go and spend the weekend with my friends in Karachi. 883 kilometers is not a very intimidating distance for one to drive. However, if I actually get into my car today, I realize that the journey is limitless. For anyone that tries going to Pakistan today, we can never get there because of all the tension and all the political aversion that our country has. So this journey is actually limitless. So we start off with optimism by saying that it's only 883 kilometers away, but the journey is actually an infinite journey. And that's where the podcast 883 to Infinity was born. Let me tell you what we talk about on this podcast. Umair and I spend an hour every week talking about subjects like culture, food, technology, content, music, art, sports, community, fashion, and current affairs, where we discuss the similarities that Indians and Pakistanis have as far as these topics are concerned. In the current affairs space, we discuss things that are relevant to the world at large today. On the last episode, we discussed the pandemic and how our countries have politicized the pandemic, where India is refusing foreign aid from Pakistan. On the episode that breaks tonight, we're talking about the Israel and Palestine conflict and how we and Indians, as Indians and Pakistanis, relate to so many similarities between the Israel and Pakistan conflict, given its nature with geopolitical conflict, given its similarities with religious conflict. So we usually spend time every week discussing India and Pakistan's stance, or the youth of India and Pakistan's stance, on a variety of different subjects. A lot of these subjects are treated with a very light-hearted tone and treatment. What do we not talk about? We don't talk about politics, religion. We don't talk about things that make us fight inherently. We don't talk about politics. We don't talk about religion, and we don't talk about cricket, because that makes us fight as well. We will definitely start talking about cricket, but over a period of time. Now, the reason we don't talk about sticky subjects like this is because, unfortunately, in India, as a lot of you know, and in Pakistan as well, a lot of our media is censored. Our media is censored to the extent where a lot of you may have read yesterday that the police had sent down its offices, had sent down its teams to the offices of Twitter, which is a large internet platform, because of the toolkit that the Congress was publicizing. And I'm sure a lot of you must have read about a variety of different scandals that have rocked the media universe during the BJP reign over the last 7 years. Now, the challenge for this, for us to talk about politics and religion, is not because we are afraid to, because it's important that we discuss the important issues and spread the right message to the youth of the country. But it's also because Umair is afraid that he lives in a country today where if he says something that does not follow the political guidelines of the of his country, he could get picked up in what he calls a black unmarked sedan and taken away for a period of 6 months. And this has happened to a variety of different people. So we've started off this podcast by identifying the similarities between our countries and the youth of our nations by discussing happy things like culture and content and food and music. Let me show you a few of the episodes that we've worked on, that we've published over the last 14 weeks. We've been live for 14 weeks now, where if you see, we've discussed things like the culture of the youth, we've discussed biryani, the origins of biryani, we've discussed love stories of couples, Indian and Pakistani couples that may have gone to college abroad or maybe working abroad that have fallen in love and come back and told their families and parents that they want to get married to an Indian / Pakistani, and then the troubles of organizing a wedding when you can't go across the border. We've discussed filmmakers who've made films on the partition or made films on the border crisis that we've had. We've discussed the role of comedy in building friendship between neighboring countries. We've discussed episodes of technology, about how technology now through virtual reality gives partition victims the ability to look at their homes that they've left behind in Pakistan or India through virtual reality goggles today as their dying wish before they move on to the next journey of their lives. So a lot of these episodes have been very eye-opening in context to different movements and different initiatives that people run with regards to the larger India and Pakistan relationship. And we don't do this alone. So listeners don't have to get bored by my boring voice. We do this by featuring a bunch of very exciting guests on our podcast every week. So Umair and I are the hosts of the podcast, and we host one or two or three guests on our podcast every week that discuss various different topics. So some of the faces on your screen may be visible to you. On the bottom right, we have a popular comedian from India called Cyrus Brocha and a popular comedian from Pakistan called Junaid Akram, who talk about the similarities in our country in the lens of comedy. Right next to that, you have Junaid Khan, who's one of Pakistan's leading musicians and film actors as well, who had toured India when he was a musician and had jammed with an up-and-coming musician, Stuart DeCosta, on your screen. And we talk about the similarities in Indian and Pakistani music and how they stem from the same roots and the same inspiration. Similarly, we have chefs, we've got filmmakers, we've got artists, we've got people who work in, we've got people who work in friendship initiatives that really tell their stories in terms of how they are changing the shape of defining friendship between India and Pakistan. Now, when we started this podcast, we were very, very nervous as to whether people would listen or what people would think about this. But it's been only 14 weeks since we've started this podcast, and we've been shocked that we have listeners in 69 countries today. I have no idea how this has happened, but we're just thankful that the podcast has a lot of traction around the world. And what this means, of course, is that there are Indians and Pakistanis, as we already know, who live in various different parts of the world. But this also means that this podcast is also being listened to by other people who are interested in either the story of India and Pakistan or the story that we're trying to tell going forward, which is the story of building friendship with its people. There are obviously some popular countries that we would expect to see here, like the United States and Hong Kong and Singapore, where there are large populace of, you know, Indians and Pakistanis. But there are some countries like Estonia and Egypt and, you know, Kenya and Yemen that have no relation to our larger countries. You know, there's some countries on this list that I hadn't even heard of. I didn't even know San Marino was a country before I started this podcast. And suddenly it started popping up on my list in terms of having an active listener base. So it's been a very interesting learning curve for us as well in terms of putting this podcast together from the perspective of putting a global listener base together. But it's not only the listeners that are listening. It's not only the listeners that are celebrating this, you know, the cause of the work that we're doing. Recently, we got featured in one of Pakistan's leading newspapers, which is The News on Sunday. We've been featured by several leading publications in India as well. Got a few screen grabs of their digital to showcase to you. Parlo is again one of Pakistan's leading lifestyle publications as well. Got a few more in India as well. And we got a feature in the Pakistan Times as well, which was our largest feature. So clearly the news is also celebrating this initiative. And I think that's really a lot of validation for us, because it's telling us that not only are consumers open to this narrative talking about friendship and peace between India and Pakistan, but it's also the media companies, it's also the news houses that want to change the narrative that our governments are trying to feed down our throat. And that's what's gotten us really excited. So what's next for us? We've got to keep going. Podcasts publish one episode every week, so we've got many, many more episodes to cover. We've got many interesting guests lined up, filmmakers. We've got a bunch of cricketers lined up for the second half of this year. We've got a bunch of interesting sports talent lined up for the rest of this year, talking about sporting rivalries between India and Pakistan, which is obviously one of the large things that define the relationship with our countries. Of course, we do hope to record one episode in person where either Umair can come down to Bombay or I can go down to Pakistan, to Karachi, to his place. And that would really be a celebration of success for us. We do hope that we can continue telling stories of friendship. And we definitely hope over a period of time that our small initiative, hopefully over a period of the next few years, can build a culture of acceptance and peace. So I've tried to keep this as short and concise as possible. That's it from me. I'm open to take any questions, time permitting, or should you have any. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Suvir. I will take the share screen off. Thank you for enlightening us on new age technologies like podcasts and the new method of distributing of information to people. Suvir, can you? I'll ask you the first question. If that's okay. Can you also share some of the commonalities that you have found between Indians and Pakistanis?
Oh yes, of course, absolutely. So as you can imagine, prior to 75 years ago, we were one country, right? And on our first episode, actually, which is called A Train to Pakistan, in which, you know, Umair and I talk about our respective journeys, and we rode the Samjhota Express respectively to go to Pakistan when I went and he came to India. The first thing we realized is the common culture of hospitality. Indians are known to have fabulous hospitality globally around the world, right? You go to hotels in Rajasthan and you receive the best hospitality you've ever received anywhere in the world. And I was personally a recipient to that as well when we went to Lahore. We were recipients of fabulous hospitality because people are inherently nice and hospitable. They want to make sure that you have a good time. They want to make sure that your needs are met. When I got off the train in Lahore, there was a police inspector standing there. And when he heard that I was from India, he didn't even let me carry my own bags. He said, "No, sir, you're a guest in our country. We will carry our bags for you." And I was a strong, fit 18-year-old that could have carried four bags myself. But yet the policeman didn't let me carry my own bag for me. The second similarity, of course, is with our food. We both have a very rich heritage with our food, with the cuisine of the north, at least with the cuisine in the north. But we're also both very passionate about our food. In Pakistan, they often joke that the national pastime of the country is eating, as it is in India as well, because we have a common love for our food. As you can imagine, a lot of similarities with regards to our music also come from the same roots, whether they define it as Sufi music or we define it as Hindustani classical music. They're built on a lot of the same theories, fundamentals, and principles, and a lot of musical influences, film influences in terms of the way we dramatize film are very, very similar. So just to summarize on a friendly note, these are the similarities that we notice. Of course, many more on a political and ideological note as well, but I'll save that conversation for another day.
Yes. Any questions, Midtowns? I think...
Vicky, can I ask a question?
Yes, please go ahead.
What is the percentage of listeners from Pakistan and India?
Sorry. So unfortunately, in Pakistan, like I said, in India, podcasting is only a two-year industry. Podcasts haven't even launched in Pakistan, unfortunately, believe it or not. So what we do every week when we publish an episode is we convert the episode into a very simple file, which we upload on YouTube and Facebook. So on my podcasting platform, the percentage of listeners from Pakistan is negligible. But on YouTube and Facebook, 100% of my listeners are from Pakistan. So if I had to give you a ratio, I would say that for every three Indians that are consuming the podcast, we have one Pakistani that consumes it across all platforms. There's a ratio across the board. which is a very healthy ratio, I would say, given the fact that our population is about 6 times Pakistan's population.
No, what I meant was worldwide, compared to the rest of the world and India and Pakistan, what's the ratio?
So we have about 50% of our listeners that come from India and Pakistan, and 50% from the other 67 countries from the rest of the world.
That's good. That's a good ratio. Yes.
That's right. In fact, some of us, India, US, UK, Singapore, as you can imagine, Italy is a leading country. And we have, Italy is our fourth largest country in terms of our listener base. Spain, Portugal are our fifth and sixth largest countries in terms of our listener. So a lot of European consumption. Recently, over the last month, we've got a lot of penetration in the Middle East and North Africa as well, where there, of course, are a lot of Indians and Pakistanis.
Indians, yeah.
Yeah, that's right.
So what sort of subjects are taught, are interesting for the Pakistanis from us?
So you mean what kind of subjects do the Pakistanis find interesting?
Yes.
Okay.
Like, I would just frame it a more limited way.
Sure.
Is, let's say, the areas of art, music, or business, you know, which is popular throughout the world.
Yeah.
Do those things interest Pakistan, or do they feel much superior, or do they feel they're coming to a kafir land?
So, you know, when it comes to things that are very, very deep rooted in culture with regards to, for example, art, for example, music, they don't say this, but they feel like they are far more superior to the rest of the world when it comes to their interpretation of art and music. The influx of Sufism in influencing art and music. We've done episodes with artists, Indian artists, and with Pakistani artists. We've done episodes with Indian fashion designers and Pakistani fashion designers. We've done episodes with Indian musicians and Pakistani musicians. And we feel that they are so much more passionate about telling their stories through the form of art and music and culture. I feel that, you know, in India, a lot of these industries, which are very culturally based when it comes to art and music and culture, have started to become industries and have started to become commercial in nature. So we look at it from the perspective of, oh, this artist has been able to sell this painting for 5 lakh rupees. But they look at it from the perspective of, oh, this artist is able to tell his story through oil and canvas, or able to tell his story through, you know, on a 70mm film through, you know, through theater. And they don't necessarily link a lot of these cultural elements with their commercial feasibility as a business. And I've noticed that to be a very big fundamental difference between Indians and Pakistanis when we perceive our own cultural interests. Of course, when it comes to business, Pakistan doesn't compare itself with a country like India, whose economy is $2.7 trillion, or the rest of the world at large, because they have a long, long catch up to go. But I feel when it comes to these more cultural insights, they have a significant advantage over a lot of other countries that I've experienced in my own personal capacity.
But so we're in the contemporary world.
Yeah.
I'm an artist, so I can say tell you by my experience that the contemporary art from there is either very imitative of what is in America. It's not as powerful as that which was expressed through their stories, you know, like sure. their stories, because it is imitative, because it is not themselves.
Sure.
And therefore it lags behind India, because sure. India is not that far. It is also imitative, but it is also getting very independent in asserting what it wants to
I
say.
See. I see. I think, fortunately, I just had the good fortune of...
Do you find an East and West thing combined together from the Eastern part of the world to a Western world? Then it could make meaning, because then one would be a force to say something to the West and amalgamate a thought.
That's true. That's true. In fact, I think I've just been fortunate to have interviewed and interacted with maybe old timers from, you know, the earlier years of the rise of Pakistani art. So I guess that's just been my good fortune. But of course, we in time to come, we definitely will get a glimpse of what contemporary artists are doing as well. So thanks for that insight, Suruchi. Appreciate it.
Thank you for all this exposure.
Can I add something, Vicky?
Yes, Mohan Shani, and after that, Lotika.
Yeah. It's very lovely to have you and to hear from you. I was born and brought up in Karachi, and I was 19 years old when I came away. So I had a great schooling, college, everything there. and a lovely time. I was a member of the Karachi Club, swimming pool, so many things. And so I have a lot of love for Pakistan and Karachi. What are some other things which you think India can do to bring us closer to Pakistan, whether it's political or whether it is some cultural thing or something that can really bring us back together?
So thank you for sharing your story, Mohan. Appreciate it. As far as the political things are concerned, I'll try and not on a public forum try and voice any views, but more than happy to chat with you offline about that. We try and stay away from, you know, sharing any public points of view on politics, like I said, purely because it's so controversial, and unfortunately if one person doesn't agree, you know, it just kind of spirals out of control and it becomes a tutu meme. But on the cultural front, there are some very, very riveting stories that we've heard about what people are doing to kind of bring people, you know, closer. One story we interviewed was of a group of people called Agaz e Dosti, which is a friendship initiative, which has a faction in both India and in Pakistan. And they're headquartered in Kashmir, actually, in Indian-occupied Kashmir and Pakistani-occupied Kashmir. And what they do is, you know, when we were in school and we were in college, we had pen pals. And we would write to pen pals with universities in UK, US, wherever it may be. What they do is at a school level, they create pen pal relationships between schools in India and Pakistan. And every time there's a, you know, big occasion, or it may be Eid, you know, the Indian students from the ages of 8 years old are drawing happy Eid cards and sending it to their pen pals in Pakistan. And the Pakistanis are drawing, you know, cards for us and writing letters to us and sending. And from the age of eight, school children are taught cultural tolerance and acceptance, saying that these are your friends, these are not your enemies, you know. In fact, Raza Khan, I put his picture up on one of the slides, was the Pakistani head of Agaz e Dosti. He was actually picked up and tortured by the ISI for 7 months because they suspected that he was communicating with India and they thought that he was working for the RAW or something of the sort. Another wonderful initiative that I spoke to last month is called Project Dastan. And I'm not sure, Mohan, whether you're familiar with the idea of virtual reality, but essentially what they do is, if you contacted them and you told them, look, I lived in Karachi pre-47 and I would love to see my home, they would go there with six cameras and they would film what is in place of your home today, and they would put it into a virtual reality headset, and they would come to you, to your house in Bombay today, and put that virtual reality headset on your head like this, and believe that the six cameras that are at your home are broadcasting images to you, and you would believe that you're back in your hometown today. And you could probably talk to the person that's living in your house today or interact with their family and exchange your stories of what life was like when you were there. There are the number of initiatives we see actually just blow us away. And I feel that people don't even know about the good work that happens when it comes to spreading positive messages between, you know, our respective countries. And that's the reason why we've started this podcast, actually, to tell these stories, you know, to tell stories of initiatives like Agaz e Dosti or Project Dastan, or our next episode where we're discussing Sunday Afternoons, which is with a Pakistani artist who tells stories of, you know, partition through her paintings. And, you know, another one was with another artist called Manisha Baswani, whose slide I had here, who runs a project called Postcards from Home, where she goes across the border and films artists who paint about partition. And she, you know, films them and photographs them and shares their pictures across the world. And I feel there are so many of these beautiful initiatives that we just don't know about as a modern society.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you.
Nice. May I have Lotika? Do you want something?
Thank you. No question, but I wanted to share some experiences. So like you, I'm a Sindhi, and like you, as a teenager, I had visited Pakistan because we had some family over there. And, you know, the first time my parents visited, they got back the addresses of, you know, kids my age who were also joining medical college at that point of time. And we started writing letters. We were pen friends with each other. And we continued to write all through medical college. And today they're all settled in US. Of course, newer technologies now, we are still well connected through either Facebook, WhatsApp, Instagram, whatever. And our children are also well connected through that. And you're very right that, you know, over there, the hospitality is so good. It's incredible, the hospitality. And the warmth which they receive you. I remember when I had graduated and I had gone to Pakistan, there were some of my dad's patients who were all set to give me a place in a village. They said, we will give you one village. You just come and practice over here. Unfortunately, I had to decline, but it's a good experience. And it's very nice that you're doing this podcast to, you know, get both sides together, because I think we as Sindhis need to know a little more about what Sindh is today. Because it's very different from what our parents or our grandparents left it as. And yet there are a lot of things which are still very similar. And culturally, of course, we bond on many issues. And, you know, in fact, the day that Javed Miada, the match which he hit a six on a last ball, we were very much in Hyderabad, Sindh, watching the match together. And once the match got over, everybody was silent because we didn't know how to react to it. And it was a very incredible experience. But then it's okay. I mean, one side has to win or lose. So.
Absolutely.
Good. Continue the good work that you're doing.
Thank you so much. Thank you for sharing that with us. Mr. Naiman has asked a question in the comments, which I'm happy to take. He says, how and where do we hear your podcast? So you can hear my podcast on absolutely any platform that you're most comfortable with, whether it be Facebook or YouTube. All you have to do is just type out 883 to infinity and you'll find us there. Or if you're familiar with podcasting platforms such as Savan or Gaana or Spotify or Apple Music, we're available on every single platform that you can potentially imagine. Just punch in 883 to infinity and you'll find us on the platform that is most convenient to you. In fact, on the platforms like Facebook and YouTube, we've now also started recording the video of our guests. So we upload videos as well. But on Savan and Gaana and Spotify and Apple Podcasts, we upload audio only.
Thanks.
Thank you.
Sumit, I have a question. Can I?
Yes, of course, Sapna.
Yeah. So without sounding controversial, just wanted to understand, what is the status of women right now in the country of Pakistan? Has it improved? Because we know that Malala was a product of Pakistan and, you know, her idea was to improve the lot of the women in Pakistan. So as youth out there, are you all, you know, taking any initiatives somehow to, you know, improve the status of women over there?
So it's interesting you asked that question. Actually, episode 7, we discussed youth culture and we had a youth representative who was female specifically address this issue. And of course, we did a lot of our own homework before we do every episode, and it gave me the opportunity to do some research as well in terms of what the status of women was historically over the last 75 years to where it's come today. And, you know, a lot of so this question actually has two prongs to it. The first prong, unfortunately, is politicized, right? And the second prong, unfortunately, I shouldn't be saying unfortunately, but that's the reality of the matter, is very culturally driven. So when I say culturally driven, in different parts of the world, in different cultures, we follow, in a lot of cultures, we follow very, very patriarchal systems in terms of organization, whether it's at a familial level or whether it's at a, you know, even a larger social level or whether it's at a business level today. In India, over the last, I would say 5, 7, 8, 10 years, like on the business front, you've seen so many women becoming business leaders today. Women have been in politics in India for a long time, so I shouldn't, but, you know, entering the workspace and becoming business leaders today. India's always had a considerably more equitable ground when it comes to women as far as things like driving is concerned or voting is concerned, which my generation actually, to be honest, takes for granted, right? We never even thought that suffrage would have been, a topic of conversation. May it have been in the 19th century, you know, two centuries ago, but my generation takes things for granted. But like in slightly more regressive countries like the UAE, in my lifetime itself, or Saudi Arabia, actually, in my lifetime itself, they've approved, they authorized women voting and driving, for instance. In Pakistan, however, it's, it's interesting. In Pakistan, it's not culturally, how should I say, it's not culturally popular for women to enter the workspace in leading business roles. Our generation has changed that completely. Our generation has changed it from two perspectives. One is they're breaking gender stereotypes by entering the corporate world. And the second is a lot of how should I say, a lot of social initiatives in Pakistan are also led by women. So we are doing it. We've recorded an episode, for example, about animal care in Pakistan and what importance Pakistan face as a country or as a society, the time they spend on, you know, rehabilitation of animals, abused animals, etc. I was very, very pleasantly surprised to see that all these social initiatives that we cover are all led by women, you know, and women are being encouraged to enter. And maybe that's the first step of entering, you know, the workspace in that context, but are being encouraged to enter. We interviewed, revolutionary fashion company called FTWA. It's pronounced Fatwa, very, very controversial name by itself. And it's led by a bunch of homosexual women in Pakistan who are trying to break the social, cultural, gender stereotypes when it comes to social acceptance of women, when it comes to the workplace, when it comes to homosexuality, when it comes to doing things like, you know, being slightly, different or alternative in terms of their lifestyle and culture. And I feel that our generation is doing a great job by putting themselves out there. Social media is really helping because every time they do something, they're broadcasting it on social media and getting a lot of attention and validation from the global community as well. And the minute it gets attention and validation from the global community, it has to get acceptance from the local domestic community as well. And I feel that's becoming considerably more socially acceptable. While there may not be necessarily many movements to encourage it, for those that are passionate themselves, it's being very well accepted and celebrated on all fronts.
Okay.
Can I ask?
That's good to hear.
Yes, Anil has a question.
Yeah. And before I ask my question, I must say absolutely delightful to hear you. Something new we learned. And before I ask my question, I want to share, I'm motivated by what Lutika said. You know, my father's from Lahore and he was a UN expert in Africa. And one day at 11 o'clock at night, somebody knocked on his door. And what happened was there was a Pakistani diplomat who had come there on UN assignment. And the UN resident representative, he asked him, are there any Indians and Pakistanis here? He says, no, there are not many people. But he said, okay, name, not Pakistani, but Indian. He says, yeah, there's one Ambo. Now, Ambo is a very unique surname. There's no Ambo in the world except my family. And he and dad were together in school in class 5. At 11 in the night, he had the confidence and courage to knock on our door and at 11 o'clock night, and he said, banged, and he said, ask, Ambo, and can you believe after, this happened in the 80s, and they must be in school in 40s or wherever, my father is now not even alive. Can you believe? And when he said, Ambo, my father replied, Dillo. That was his pet name. And that, and the way they met, there was no, India, Pakistan, the kind of warmth and friendship was tremendous, tremendous. Yeah. Okay, coming to my question, what is the revenue model for sustaining this activity? Because very interesting. And how does one participate in your podcast besides YouTube and Facebook? Directly, when you say Savan, etc., how does one get onto them?
Sure. So I'll take your first question first. The revenue model for podcast actually is like any other media company. We earn revenue in two fashions. One is over a period of time when our podcast becomes popular and we get millions of listeners. Hopefully, if it works and we get millions of listeners, we'll get advertisers. Like any show on television or any platform streaming or web series gets advertisers, we'll get advertisers. We are cognizant of the fact that our podcast is slightly controversial in nature, so we won't get advertisers. And we've made our peace with that. But the second stream of revenue is that we can activate a subscription fee on our podcast on these leading platforms like Spotify and Apple, which means that if you subscribe to my podcast, they'll charge you a nominal subscription fee, which will only be a few hundred or a few thousand rupees every year, in which Apple or Google or whoever the intermediary company is will take between 15 and 20% as their commission, and they'll give the balance revenue to us. But we are not doing this podcast specifically with commercial intentions in mind. It comes purely from the passion of our hearts. And there are many other podcasts that I'm pursuing, which we're doing commercially, but not this one. To answer your second question, so the answer that I gave you about monetization is more for podcasts in general, may not apply to this podcast. To answer your second question, saying how do you, sorry, would you, can you ask your second question again, please?
YouTube? I mean, how do I get on to Savan, and are there subscription? I mean, you have to subscribe them or just get into Savan? And
they're all free apps. If you have Savan or Gaana on your cell phone, or you could just download it from the app store. They're all free apps. You could just download it from the app store. And once it's installed on your cell phone, you just need to go to the search bar and type 883 space 2 space infinity, 883 to infinity. And you'll get our podcast that will appear there on any podcasting.
TO2.
8832 infinity. And on any platform, once it's installed on your cell phone, you just need to punch it into the search bar. It'll appear there. Make sure to hit the subscribe button, because once you hit the subscribe button, you'll get a notification every week. We upload new episodes every Wednesday. So it'll give you a notification saying the new episode's released today. Like today's episode tonight will release about the Israel-Palestine similarities to India and Pakistan. And you'll get a notification. If you find it interesting, you just click on the notification and the episode will stream for you. Typically, each episode is between 40 and 60 minutes.
Thank you, Anil, for the question. Any more questions? Anybody has any questions? Okay, I'll ask the final question. You know, your podcast is labeled 883 to infinity. When do you think, or do you think it'll ever come a day when it'll be, you will make a podcast 883 to arrival?
Well, we definitely hope so. If on my last slide, actually, I'd written that as one of our goals, saying that we definitely want to record our future, not all, obviously, but at least one or two novelty episodes together, where either I can host Umair in Bombay, or he can host me in Karachi, and we do both versions of them. And the fact that myself, along with several other people on this call, have had the opportunity to go to Pakistan, I'm sure there will be a day very soon where, you know, we will open borders again and things will be slightly less hostile than they are today. And I hope that we can play a very, very small part in that by, you know, people changing their ideas and their opinions by listening to the stories that we tell. So fingers crossed, and thanks for the support.
Look forward to it. Thanks. Suvir, and the initiative you've taken is very noble, a very noble cause, and helping break the stereotype of people and their mentality. And hopefully we will listen to your podcast we will get closer to our neighbors in some manner, and paving the way for greater friendship between our two countries.
Thank you so much for having me. It's been a pleasure. Thanks so much.
So may I now request...